excited. This is the day the Lord hath made, a little cooler day than we've had lately, but we need the rain that's supposed to come today, so hopefully we all get home before it starts to pour, because I saw coming over, it's 100% chance of rain this afternoon, so that means we're going to get some, but we need it. Welcome to worship here at Virgus United Methodist Church. I'm Pastor Joyce. It's my honor and privilege to serve you as well as the community of Virgus. Glad that you're here in person, and glad that those of you that are worshiping with us online are there as well for this time of praising God and giving thanks and sharing our joys and concerns and all the things that go into worship. So glad that you're all here. You can see the announcements. I wanted to add a special thank you to the highway cleanup crew. I was hearing some talk that they were the oldest highway cleanup crew in the state. I don't know, Dent might give you a run for your money because they were out there too this past week, but I want to thank all the people, all the gentlemen that helped with that, and Rick for organizing and just getting people together and getting it done. So thank you for that. We're needing another volunteer for Feed My Starving Children. We had an extra one, but Rick and Margie can't go on Saturday, so we're needing another person or two. Dent also needs a person. With Russ's passing, he was signed up to help with that. So if you can help with that, talk to Faye and let her know that you can help. And if you want to give anything towards the $500 that we contribute to cover the cost of the food that we'll pack, you can just mark that on your check that's for FMSC, Feed My Starving Children. You don't have to write out that whole big, long thing. But they asked us for $50 per volunteer or $500 as a whole. So if you want to help towards that, that would be wonderful. Are there any announcements from the congregation? Anything anybody would like to share?
On our announcements, they have Feed Starter Children for Friday.
That's dense, yeah. Ours is Saturday at 12:30?
No, it's at 11 to 1.
11 to 1, okay. Okay. And the book club is there, and Dent is having its rummage sale. If you're doing some spring cleaning and you want to get rid of some stuff, you can certainly call me, and I'll arrange to meet you over there. We can get your stuff, or if you want to save it for our rummage sale in July, you can do that. But my sister, when she gets ready to get rid of something, she wants it out of her house, like now. So I took a couple of bags of clothes from her, and Dent does take clothes for their rummage sale. So anything else from anybody? All right, well, let's start our worship with our opening unison prayer. Please pray with me. Slow us down,
God, and speed us up. Let us be slow to speak out in judgmental anger, and quick to offer words of encouragement and understanding. Enable us to catch the vision of a life in which the creeds and deeds are one, and make the vision our own. Enable us to catch the vision of lives seeking similarities rather than differences, of common ground rather than divergent roads. Enable us to catch the vision of Jesus, in whom all things are one. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Join me in the call to worship. And please stand if you may. God's love, strong and true,
beckons us to walk on with hope in each step, lures us home to the place just right.
God's love, everlasting and bold,
sustains us when fear closes in and worry overwhelms, surprises us with the glimpses of wonder and bursts of joy.
God's love, gentle yet persistent,
graces us with rest in the midst of busyness, calms us to follow the good path.
God's love, abundant and uplifting,
dances around us like waves on the shore,
dwells in us as a song steeped in praise.
God's love forever leading us to sing and pray, serve and praise.
And please remain standing as we sing hymn number 384, Love Divine, All Love Excelling, the verses that are indicated, 1, 2, and 3.
Seated. So if we'd had any little ones today, I had some props to show them, a washcloth and a bar of soap. I was going to ask them, what do you do with that? Well, you clean, you keep yourself clean, you keep your house clean. So then I said, what if I told you these words? Everyone who cleans is born of God and knows God. And whoever does not clean does not know God, because God is clean. So I was going to ask them to tell me, so what does that scripture say we're supposed to do? Well, it says we're supposed to clean, right? And that God is clean. So if we really believed that God was clean, we'd be cleaning all the time, right? Our houses would be perfect. And I don't know about your house, but my house is not perfectly clean. I violated my mom's, when you go away, make sure your dishes are, you know, not in the sink and everything. And I went down to the cities this weekend and came back last night, and there was a plate, a bowl, and a cup that didn't fit in the dishwasher, and they're still sitting in my sink, so my mom would not be happy. I didn't come home to a clean house. So, and we would try to be very clean people, right? If this is what the words were. But I just made that up. It's not God is clean. The Bible does say something similar. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. So what does that tell us? Well, that tells us we're supposed to love each other and be kind to each other. So if we really believe that God is love, then we would do those things, and we would try to be not clean people, but loving people. So I want you to think about that too, because that's what we're going to talk about in the main sermon. So hopefully you will get as much out of my main sermon as you do out of the children's sermon, though I often had people tell me, say, oh, I loved your children's sermon today. It was so good. And they wouldn't say a word about the regular sermon. So sometimes short and sweet is good, because you get to the point. But we come to that time where we share God moments and joys and concerns. So does anyone have a God moment that they've experienced this past week that they want to share? Yes.
Well, I haven't been in church much this month. It's been a very busy month. Wayne and I moved. I had a 3-day weekend seminar, and then the last 4 days I went down to Florida to get mom. So it's been a very busy month.
Yeah.
But on the 13th of April, Wayne and I moved to a new household. Well, we both, more Wayne than I, are collectors of stuff. Lots of stuff. We're not hoarders, but we're collectors of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So that morning at 10 a.m., I had 12, 13, 14 family members and great friends, one sitting to my left over here, came over. We loaded. It was 71 degrees. Mm-hmm. That morning it was warmer than heck. We sweated. We moved. I had two younger guys from the house help me move. And I stopped for about 4.5 seconds at one point and just looked around. And I thank God for all the people I have.
Yeah.
It's a big job to move. And in your 20s, probably not so bad, but in your 50s and 60s, like Wayne and I are, and all of our ages, mostly everybody in here, it's tough to move.
It is.
Things get heavier the older we get.
Yeah. I remember I told you I'm not real good at going up and down stairs, and you said, yeah, we're finding we aren't either.
No, we aren't.
So,
yeah. It was a God moment.
God moment. Just all those people stopped. That came together. Yeah,
for a few seconds, I actually stopped and just looked around, which, you know, I was moving all day, and it was like, wow, look at this. This is just incredible.
Yeah.
People really come out when you need the help, and it's awesome. And that is God. That is not me.
That is God
working in us.
Yeah. Yeah. Working in those around us. Yeah. Dave.
Our son got married a week ago on Saturday.
Yes.
And I consider that a God moment.
Yes. Definitely.
It was a wonderful traditional wedding. We had people that says it was so nice to hear the name God and Jesus used in a wedding ceremony. So
yeah.
We consider God, and I consider that a God moment.
Yes, yes. And we did pray for them last Sunday and their marriage and everything. So, other God moments that anybody had? All right, any joys to celebrate today? Anything you want to give God thanks and praise for? Yes,
sir. Lilza's cousin and her husband were down on Friday rather unexpectedly for a visit. They're just very pleasant people.
So a nice time.
Always a nice joy to visit with them.
Yeah. That's good, because family isn't always pleasant sometimes. And surprise visits can go one way or the other, depending. So that's wonderful. Other joys or things to celebrate?
I have a joy because my last Sunday in the church down there was emotional, to say the least. They're wonderful people. And then I came back here and I walked in this morning and I'm going, this is home.
Yeah, yeah. We're glad to have you back. We're glad to have you back. And that everything went well coming home. One of the Dent members, Ellie Loden, was coming back from Arizona, where she spends the winter, and had a very serious car accident in Kansas City. She's not quite sure what happened, but she must have gone up something because she launched herself and came down. And if you saw the pictures of the car, it was a God moment that she came through that. And the first person that stopped was a former police officer and EMT. So she was able to get herself out of the car. She's not sure how she did that, but so she's quite bruised up and sore and things like that, but glad to be here. So what kinds of, yeah, Brian.
A praise and a concern.
Okay.
My wife, Eileen, is down in Stillwater taking care of the grandkids, Thomas and Rochelle, well, our daughter is off doing her business stuff.
Oh, okay.
Which is good. The concern is our neighbor lady, who many of you have met, Jan Rupert Larson, mm-hmm. the lady with four cats.
Yeah.
She's visiting a grandson in the East Coast in Virginia. He's in the Navy and with family out there. And she missed a step and fell down and had a serious break to her leg. Upper leg, she said, below the hip. So right now, as we speak, she's probably in a surgery in Virginia Beach.
Getting that fixed, okay.
We will pray for Jan. Anything else that we can pray for? Yes, Donna.
How are you doing? Praying for all the people that were involved in those nasty tornadoes.
Okay, Margie?
My sister Barb, who is in internet care for, because she was the one that was in the hospital and had that fracture hip. Had good news there. She's going to be able to probably go home tomorrow.
Okay.
And they can just barely see a hairline fracture there, so it healed on its own. They were really pleased.
So the fracture is healing.
Oh, that's good. Any other concerns we can lift up this morning? Yes, Lorna.
Two of my friends from New Orleans, Minnesota, live in Florida in the same area that I am in the winter time. I think I had prayers for him last year because he went through horrific cancer surgery. He had cancer up in his sinuses and lost the sight of one eye. But he came through it well. He's
okay.
Had reconstructive surgery done now because he had bumped through the roof of his mouth. So they have some done this year. However, his wife became ill shortly before they came back. They came back up from Minnesota on the same day we were on. And had a real serious gallbladder attack, and they wanted to do emergency surgery there, down in Florida.
Okay.
She wanted to come home, and they did get back to Minnesota safely, south of the airport. But they both have a long
recovery ahead of them. And what are their names again, Lorna?
Ed and Rhonda.
Ed and Rhonda, okay. So prayers for Ed and Rhonda, who've had various health concerns. Rhonda, emergency gallbladder surgery, and Ed recovering again from cancer and things. So prayers for strengthening and healing for them. Anything else? Yeah, Margie.
Yeah, I just wanted to say that both Joan and George Bolick passed away. Joan in January and George in February. So I guess prayers for their children.
Yeah, we think that...
Was it George's brother that... just didn't have any way to contact us, didn't have a number, so unfortunately we didn't know that they had passed away. But George and Joan Bolig have both passed away this past winter. Yeah.
Can I take up 2 minutes and read something? We've been praying for Lee Kramer, who was undergoing treatments in Mexico for his Lyme's disease.
Right, right.
So this was sent from him and his wife to the family. They did one text for the whole family.
Okay.
So it says, this is from Lee Kramer to his family members. I'm happy to say we have finished treatment. Mother had a couple IVs and follow up with Dr. Bridget. Our 1 month at StemAid consisted of 80 IVs, 24 rounds of stem cells, 4 EVOO blood, I don't know what that is, 2 blood draws, 5 energy tests, 750 injections, 4 massages, and 2 painkillers. Thank God I am done. All of our tests have shown 0 Lyme, mold, or co-infections. Huge win. My body is starting to move better. I do not get massive food cravings like I used to, and my brain fog is getting better. Over the next couple of months, we will dig further into building my guide flora through diet and probiotics. We attempted to start here and ran into complications. We just need some more time to heal before we start again. Over the next 6 to 18 months, my new stem cells will repair and restore any tissue damage in my body, so things should only get better. We have loved our time in Mexico, but we will be happy to be back stateside. Thank you, Mexico. I love you, but I don't want to see you for at least 5 years. The boys did great while they were here. Otto turned into an ultra crawler, one of their young ones, and cut a couple teeth. Ellis, well, he got a sweet tan and swam a lot. Definitely a vacation for him. All we will need is a Mexican flag to put next to his pool in the backyard, and he will be living all over again come June. Thank you all once again for your support during this healing season. We are super shocked that this all worked out. 65 days ago, we were 20 pounds lighter and in a very dark place. Look at what God has done for me. Amen. Happy Easter weekend. He is risen.
He is risen indeed. Yeah.
Do you know this call out? God is good
all
the time.
God is good.
Amen. Amen. Any other concerns that we can pray for today? All right, well, let's go to God in a time of prayer. I'll pray for these concerns and then ask you to join me in the Lord's Prayer. O God of light and source of beauty, you are the one to brighten our darkness. You give us the rainbow after the storm and the daffodil to cheer our spring mornings. God of light, kindle a flame within us. Let us be expressions of your love and instruments of your peace. Source of wonder, awaken in us that holy space that knows, feels, experiences, and shares wonder, awe, and amazement. God of light and source of beauty, we are sometimes shy in your presence, sometimes undeserving of your favor, yet you love us and care for us. You lavish your grace, your unconditional love upon us beyond measure, overflowing our every expectation. So we bow before you and we rise to praise you. We thank you for people who are helpers in our lives, whether it's moving or helping after a car accident. We are just grateful for those who love and help us. We are grateful, O God, that you were part of John and Elizabeth's marriage ceremony and that you will be a part of their lives. We ask you to bless them and keep them strong in their married life. We give thanks for family and a good visit and time with them. We thank you that Lorna is back. We thank you that Ellie is recovering from her car accident. We thank you for all the experiences we have with grandchildren. But we also ask you, O God, to be with those that are struggling, that need your healing touch. And we remember Brian and Eileen's neighbor, Jan, who is dealing with a broken leg. If she's in surgery now, we ask you to guide and direct her medical team to knit those bones back together the way that they need to be so that they will heal and she will be able to be as active as she was. We pray for all the people affected by tornadoes and other natural disasters. We know these things do not come from you, O God, that the world is a place where bad things sometimes happen. And so we pray for relief agencies and again, friends who love, who reach out to help in these times. We give thanks that Barb will be going home, that her fractured hip is healing. We ask you to continue to strengthen her and also her husband. We pray for Ed and Rhonda, who are in recovery from various health concerns, that you would be with them, that you would strengthen them and send people to help them. We ask your presence to be with the families of Joan and George Bolig, who passed away this past winter, who were a part of our fellowship. Be with those families, give them hope and encouragement. And we give thanks and we give you all the praise, O God, for Lee's 100% recovery from his Lyme disease. We ask you to be a part of his life with more healing and strengthening over the next 6 months. But we thank you, O God, for your work in his life, not just in the healing and medical, but in his personal life as well. He offers his praise to you, as do we. So we pray all these things in Jesus' name, and we join together to pray as he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our next hymn is in our small hymnal, so you might want to get that so you have the music, but you might also be familiar to you. They'll know we are Christians by our love. It's number 2223 in the Faith We Sing hymnal. And please stand as you're able as we sing this together. As we prepare to give our tithes and offerings, these words of prayer. We give our gifts, O God, in love and thanksgiving for all that we have been given by you. Help us give with hearts and minds open to the possibilities of what we can do to heal the brokenness of our world. Let our love travel where we cannot, making pathways of peace where there are none. We pray all this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Prayer of Illumination. Holy God, as Jesus taught his disciples, so teach us as your word is read and proclaimed. Prepare our hearts to be fertile soil in which your truth may be planted deeply, watered frequently, and harvested richly. Amen. First scripture reading is from 1 John chapter 4. Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love. God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. And this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Beloved, since God loved us so much, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love is perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him, and he is in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and do testify that the Father has sent his Son as the Savior of the world. God abides in those who confess that Jesus is the Son of God, and they abide in God. So we have known and believe the love that God has for us. God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. Love has been perfected amongst us in this, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in his world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, for here fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. We love because he first loved us. Those who say, "I love God," and hate a brother or sister are liars. For those who do not love a brother or sister whom they have seen cannot love God whom they have not seen. The commandment that we have from him is this: those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
So Dave said, make it short so I can get home to watch football or baseball. I don't know what football he's watching, but maybe you're watching the AFL or whatever. But I said, I'm going to talk about baseball. So Yankees game opening day last year took 2 hours and 30 minutes, said baseball fan Molly Knight. The pitch clock is amazing. The greatest thing since the invention of baseballs, said Neil Best. And the game has a cadence that would be familiar to Ted Williams and Sandy Koufax, unhurried but crisp, said Ben Goldfarb. I love it. So they're talking about the pitch clock. It's a big help, even if your team is terrible. Jeff Schwartz didn't have to watch the Giants play for 3 hours. Instead, it only took 2 hours and 30 minutes for them to get shut out. Echoing others, Royce Young said, it feels like I'm watching a new sport. It's a whole new ball game. Apologies to those of you that aren't baseball fans, but these fans are talking about a change that was introduced last season in the major league, the pitch clock. It was a part of an effort to make the game shorter and more exciting. The pitch clock is, quote, a kind of pacemaker to re-regulate the game's lagging heartbeat, writes Mark Leibovich in The Atlantic. Pitchers are now, quote, allowed just 15 seconds to begin their motion to deliver the baseball to home plate, he explains. And hitters have to be set in the batter's box by the 8-second mark. Now, this might seem like a small adjustment, but it's actually a pretty radical change. Previously, pitchers could take as long as they wanted between throws, and batters could shuffle around endlessly in the batter's box. So the goal, says Leibovich, is to curtail dead time in the game. The endless velcroing and re-velcroing of batters' gloves, or strolling around the mound, or making a big deal of how you pitch. And it works. We're seeing a whole new ball game, one that's faster and more thrilling and exciting. So those were rules that the game of baseball used to be under, and now they're under new rules. And for centuries, God's people lived by complex religious regulations. Think about the Ten Commandments, laws about clean and unclean foods, rules about ritual and moral holiness. And these regulations went on and on and on, like a baseball game that just seems like it's never going to end. But then God's love was revealed in Jesus. And the compassion and mercy of God became visible through Jesus' life, death, and resurrection. And this inspired John the Evangelist to offer a new rule to the followers of Jesus in the first century when this scripture was written. Let us love one another because love is from God. This change came from the discovery that love is at the very heart of God's will for our lives. And that's a whole new ballgame. John knew that love had been a part of the God game for many years. In fact, the commandment, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, didn't come originally from Jesus. He was quoting Leviticus in the Old Testament. But the game changed when God chose to put a human face, the face of Jesus, on the commandment. So God's love was revealed among us in this way, said John. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we loved God, but that God loved us and sent his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. So that word atoning is one that may not be all that familiar. It comes from the bigger word atonement. But you can break that down to three words, at one ment, at one with God. So because of the sinful nature of human beings, we were separated from God. But through Jesus Christ, we were reconciled and he atoned. He made us at one again with God. So why was this change necessary? Well, some people would say, we like the game the way it is. The problem with the love commandment in Leviticus is that it could easily become a matter of endless philosophical debates. Like the attorney, the lawyer who says to Jesus, but who is my neighbor? You could debate that and it would invalidate the purpose of the commandment. It's like discussions about the infield fly rule. So John changed the rule by attaching it to the sacrifice of Christ. So now when we look at Jesus on the cross, we see the love of God for us. We discover that even before we could express our love, God showed love by sending Jesus to be an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Jesus died to show God's love for us and to restore the relationship with God that had been broken by our sin. So now when we look at Jesus, we can see God's love revealed. We see the loving face of God. Like the introduction of the pitch clock, this change had a powerful effect. Beloved, since God loved us so much, says John, we also ought to love one another. So suddenly the love of God in Jesus became more than just a good idea. It became a vivid illustration of how we are to love. So in addition, John found that God helps us when we attempt to love. God abides in us, he said, and his love is perfected in us. With this intervention, we can be confident that God is with us and working through us, like Lorna was saying with the people that came to help. God is working through us in those situations. Our love gets faster and stronger because it's based on the activity of God. New Testament professor Clifton Black says, God's love for us is the source of our power to love God and love one another. John says we love because he first loved us, he, God. God's love is the source of our power, making it possible for us to love. The result, says John, is that those who love God must love their brothers and sisters also. And when we show that kind of love, God lives in us, and God's love is perfected in us. So the rules began to change when God's love was revealed in Jesus. With the arrival of Christ, the compassion and mercy of God became visible to the world. Then God promised to live in us and perfect his love in us so that we would be able to love one another. And this transformation occurred when John discovered that love is the heart of God's identity. And John captured this fact in three simple but very profound words. God is love. Think about that for a minute. God is love. So not only does Jesus reveal God's love, but Jesus reveals that God is love. And that's a game changer. For many people, or maybe even for some of you, you grew up with a God or a God that was talked about that was an angry God, that was a punishing God, that was a God that was looking to get you at every opportunity when you messed up. And that's not what this scripture is saying. So again, the Leviticus, it was an idea, love your neighbor, but it wasn't being lived out. In the novel City of Peace, there's a pastor named Harley Camden who makes a visit to a jail to see a Muslim inmate named Muhammad Bayati, who was accused of murdering his daughter. The two men begin to talk about their beliefs, and Muhammad says, God is merciful and just. God is also love, adds Pastor Harley. Our Bible says God is love. And Muhammad cocks his head slightly and says, that's different from our understanding. We have many names for God, but love is not among them. For Christians, says Pastor Harley, love is at the core of who God is. God reveals his love by sending Jesus to bring us forgiveness and new life. And the response that we're supposed to make is to love one another, a love that should be extended to friends, enemies, blacks, whites, Muslims, Jews, fellow Christians. It's all supposed to come down to love. In fact, the Bible insists that those who say, I love God, but hate their brothers and sisters, are liars. I would agree with that, says Muhammad. Loving God does require that we love the people around us. So like baseball, religion is a change adverse game. It's hard for us to change in the church. It's hard to accept new ideas and new things. But we know if we don't be open, if we don't try to open ourselves up to that, we can't keep doing the same things the same way we've been doing them and expecting different results. That's the definition of insanity, they say. You keep doing the same thing, thinking you're going to get something different. So many people of faith prefer to play by traditional rules and are nervous about innovations that might run counter to their understandings. So just as Muhammad says to Harley, we have many names for God, but love is not among them. If we have multiple names for God, why do we need any more? Religion, like baseball, isn't always comfortable with change. Traditional baseball fans weren't happy about the pitch clock when it was first proposed. Baseball is a timeless game, they would argue. It's the only game without a clock, and it will last as long as it needs to last. So a clock wasn't part of their understanding, even though most of them wanted the game to move more quickly. They craved more action and offense, says sports writer Leibovich. More balls hit into play, more doubles, triples, and stolen bases. And finally came the innovation, the pitch clock. It was a game changer, and it was a good one. In the same way, John came along and said, God is love, changing the Christian faith forever. This assertion, God is love, is a powerful pacemaker to regulate our heartbeat, to keep us spiritually healthy, and inspire us to hopefully love one another, just as God has loved us. As Pastor Harley says to Muhammad, it's all supposed to come down to love. So this past spring, we had a Bible study called Multiplying Love. And in it, Professor Chilcote talked about a lot of things, but his main emphasis was love, that we need as Christians to love. And that maybe the new direction for the now changed United Methodist Church, after we had a lot of churches that disaffiliated from us, needs to be the way of love, that we need to be known as the Church of Love. Yes, love one another is the heart of the whole new ball game, because God is love, and those who abide in love abide in God, and God abides in them. And what abide means is to live or dwell or rest in something, to accept or observe or follow a particular path. So for John, to love God is to love our brothers and sisters. And to abide in love is to abide in God with no distinction between the two. And that's a different approach to the faith game, based on the love of God in Christ and the love that God has for each one of us. So that's part of the reason that we're going to try something new this summer. We're going to go down to the beach every Wednesday in June, July, and August, and we're going to pass out ice cream treats to who's ever there. And just say, the Virgus Methodist Church wants to bless you. We'll also have a table where there will be some coloring sheets and crayons, a Bible coloring sheet, and I'll tell a Bible story for any child that would like to sit down and listen. But they don't have to come and sit and listen to the Bible story in order to get the ice cream. It's not a bait and switch. Who's ever here, we want to bless you. And that grew out of that class, because one day one of our questions was, what could your church do for your community, to love your community? And so this idea popped up. We're also going to do a meal on the solstice, June 21st, right? I think so. And we're going to do it right over at Lions Park. We're going to provide, for sure, hot dogs. We might do hamburgers too, side dishes, a drink, that kind of thing. And so we're going to all want to be there so we can greet people. We'll have little name tags so they know we're from the church. And we're just going to say, we're glad that you're here. We want to bless you with this free meal. We're calling it a blessing outreach to the city of Virgus. So do you feel that your Christian game has a lagging heartbeat? If you install the God is love pitch clock and let it help you to love your brothers and sisters, that's a good thing. And this is a change that will, I know, draw you closer to God and to the people around you. It'll focus us on the action and keep us excited and engaged in our faith. So once you love one another, you'll never want to go back to the way the game used to be played. Alleluia. Amen. So this scripture reading just seemed to lend itself to an affirmation of faith. So I'm going to ask you to stand. I'll read my parts and you read your parts. Love is of God. God is love. If we know God, we love as God loves us.
God's divine love was revealed through God's Son, Jesus Christ.
God loves us and wants us to abide, to rest in that love.
If we love one another, God lives in us, and God's love is perfected in us.
There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out our fear.
We love because God first loved us.
And all of us together, thanks be to God. Alleluia. Amen. And remain standing as we sing our closing hymn, How Can We Name a Love, number 111 in your regular hymnal, we'll sing verses 1, 2, and 4. It's the tune of This Is My Father's World. Send one another forth with these words of blessing. And now, may we follow God's path of love and faithfulness, that we may know His grace, mercy, and peace forever. Amen. And have a blessed week. Amen.